Hey folks, well, I am back. Vijay Lakshman here. Super excited to talk to you guys about Mythborn 24/7/365. Wow, so much to talk about. First of all, the coolest thing ever, I'm actually projecting here and here. Here to YouTube and here to Facebook. So, see if this is cool. If it messes everything up, then, you know, well, we'll change it. Big news. Huge news. The audiobook is out. So if you have not gone and checked out the audiobook, oh my gosh. I turned it on last night, and my wife was laying down next to me. She was playing one of her Word with Friends games. And she was listening to the story, and she was like, oh my God, that's like really good. What is that? And I go, that's Mythborn? And she was like, that's your book? I was like, oh, this is maybe not a good advertisement for Mythborn. But still, it's so different when you have someone amazing reading the story. And I've always been a big fan of reading my own books. But there's something about hearing a great voice, reading your story. It just takes you, you know, in a nice way to another world. And Michael Kramer does a great job on this book, so I have zero complaints, and I'm very excited to be sharing the book with you. So if you get the chance, check it out on Audible. It only takes one credit. You don't have to spend any money to get it. And, you know, let me know what you think. Put the reviews up, and please let them be good, but be good and, like, try it out. I think you'll love it. I can't believe my wife had no idea that was Mythborn she was listening to. You know, they keep you grounded, right? Humble. Let's see. What else can we talk about? I am going to be at the Barnes & Noble in Rockville. This Barnes & Noble is huge. It's on Rockville Pike. It's right across or right next to the Fridays, or, you know, just before the Fridays in that shopping mall, for those of you who are familiar. It's across the street from the mattress companies and stuff. And it's a giant Barnes & Noble. I think the crossroad there is Twin Brook. So it's going to be Rockville Pike and Twin Brook Parkway. But I will be there November 10th. At 10, I mean, all day. Sorry, November 10th, all day, Saturday. And I'm really looking forward to it. So, you know, if you haven't picked up your copies of Mythborn, or if you have copies and you want to have them signed, or if you want to get a signed copy, we'll be there. I'm going to try and have copies of all three books there. Right now I'm working through the Barnes & Noble system for approving the books in their particular format for print. And hopefully it will all go smoothly. Every just so you guys know, every system that you put stuff into has a slightly different way in which they do things. And you get some really odd errors sometimes. You know, in this case with Barnes & Noble, I didn't get any errors with sizing. I got errors with my CMYK colors being 300% saturation, and their max is 240% saturation. And literally, if you like could think of something, I pride myself on knowing something about everything, and I get what CMYK is, but I don't know how to fix it, you know. So I did the typical thing of just trying to reload it again and see if maybe this time the magic daemons, I call them D-A-E-M-O-N's, daemons, within the software says yes. Oh, another thing, my kid's college fund, I owe him a lot for the ums. I have been basically, I forgot to do this a couple weeks ago, so I really want to try and keep this up, and I I think I, there's still more I owe him. There's more. So, we're getting there. We're getting there. If I can keep saying then he'll be doing fine. Hi, Facebook fans. Just looking at the camera there, just in case. So today, So I know last week when I was outdoors, I couldn't talk as much about nanotech and nanotechnology. And what's really, really cool is, you know, today I thought what I'd do is try and put a little end on that. And then I also wanted to talk a little bit about a couple of animated series that I would highly recommend people seeing. One is old and everyone knows it already, but the other one may not be as well known. And the good news is they're both made by the same people. So they did a great job. Well, mostly by the same people. So first, nanotech. So here's the crazy thing that I've been doing recently as I'm writing Mythborn 4. Mythborn 4 really does dive into what happened early in the time frame of the colonists coming to this world. How was the nanotech subverted into this magical system, or this system of, you know, mythology that has brought these demons to life and other things? And also, who were the players back then? Like, you know who Lilith is today. You know who Sovereign is today. Who are they back then? And what caused them to become the people they are today? And to do that, I had to really think through some of the magic system a little deeper, not from the standpoint of how I'd implement it in a game. That's actually, believe it or not, a little easier, because there are finite ways in which you can express yourself in a given, you know, encounter. And if you design something that basically has sort of like an action-reaction kind of system around it, then you can come up with a matrix by which you can figure out how different things ought to work. But the part that I find interesting is there are very few futuristic novels in which the future isn't just an analogy of today, but with cool gadgets replacing stuff we do. So, you know, instead of a phone being a cell phone, it's a, you know, mandibular implant that, you know, vibrates your bone and you hear the thing inside your head. Or, you know, maybe it's vision enhancements that are contact lenses or whatever. You know, I get all that, but I was thinking along the lines more of, if nanotech is so powerful, or I'm sorry, if it's powerful to the point where it can be mistaken as magic on Eden, then what must it be like in the galaxy of the race that actually crashed, you know, came to this planet? What level have they progressed in terms of using nanotechnology? And why this is important is because in the next series that I'm planning, one of those technicians ends up coming to Eden to find out why this planet is offline. And so her adventures on this planet are very, you know, salient to the magic system, you know, the nanotech system and that technology. So I've been spending time just reading about nanotech. And again, you know, it's sort of like if you look at the advent of the Kindle reader. So think about the Kindle reader, right? People, when they first came up with this idea of paper ink, all the books they created on the ebooks, they tried to mimic things that are very 2D, analogous to books, right? Turning, flipping pages and things like that. And I guess to some extent, some people didn't want the power of the technology. What they really wanted was a more compact book. And so they got what they wanted, which was essentially an electronic avatar of what they had already in their books. They could just carry more. But in my mind, that technology, that piece of technology, it actually should have changed the way in which we interact with books in general. Books could then become interactive in so many different ways. The power of an iPad allows you to be so much deeper than just the page flipping animation. You can do things like, you know, searching words, connecting things you've read, and, you know, with a computer knows where you are in the book by tracking what pages you've turned and filling out a glossary in the back based on things you found, or hiding things within the manuscript that lets you unlock new passages and, you know, new chapters that might be hidden, or, you know, having animation effects when you're reading through a cold thing, you start seeing like snowflakes on the side of the page. Nothing that distracts from your reading, but imagine being able to brush the snow aside, you know, so you can see the tracks of something, you know, after you finish reading a page and you flip the page, you get a small little animation or whatever. There's so many things that could be done when it comes to creating a more interesting interaction between what has been a lump of paper with writing on it and what we could do today. Well, in that same way, when you think of nanotechnology, these first renditions of nanotechnology are they're just sort of better uses of known uses. They're not really thinking, what would it be like? So here's a great example. You know, when you ask yourself questions, does a society that has nanotech as implemented as well as we think it's been implemented and as pronounced and myth-worn, do they need to eat? I mean, is eating now essentially a social exercise completely designed around tasting interesting new things? It's not about getting full, because essentially nanobots can synthesize whatever energy you need. There's no reason to ingest the food anymore. It's actually quite inefficient. The only reason you would do it is to try something new, to taste something you haven't tasted, potentially to, you know, see how close you can come to death before the venom is detoxified, or you know, whatever. The point is that eating is not anymore a requirement of your daily, you know, routine. What about showering? I mean, you won't get dirty with nanotech. The machines will shed that. But then the question is, what happens all day? Are you constantly leaving behind a little dust cloud of detritus off of you? So maybe showering is still important, you know? What about haircuts? Does anyone need haircuts anymore? Does anyone need to put on makeup anymore? Does anyone need to even wear clothes anymore? Can't nanites create the clothes you need in every situation? Is it just simpler to do those things because it's less energy to put the clothes on than it is to have the nanites build them out of, you know, constituents in the air surrounding you? What about transportation? Do you need a car anymore? What about space flight? What about space suits? Do you need them? What about underwater? Do you need those? Do you need even to have your body be your body anymore? You know, in the sense that if your nanites have invaded, and think about what they are cellular, duplicates of every function that your body can do. So they could theoretically duplicate your brain. And so if they could do that, aside from the moral implications of having two of you, potentially a flesh and blood version, and then a flesh and blood but built from nanites version, because what's the difference between a nanitic cell and a red blood cell? They both do the same thing. Maybe the nanite cell has a slight piece of technology associated with it, but any technology at that level is going to look biological. So at some level, it's going to be made out of organic compounds. It's going to have small little engines within it. There's still a mystery today as to how our bodies have the ATP, the mitochondria. It feels like a separate engine put within the cell, and it has a separate evolutionary track. It doesn't match up, and it's still a big mystery as to how and why we have a mitochondria cell within our cells. But it makes a lot of sense if you're engineered, because, you know, every cell needs a power source. And, you know, maybe what we find is that food, turn the whole thing around and look back all the way through it again. Maybe you do need to eat, because the quickest way to power those cells is to create a food digestion system that your blood then transfers all the sugar that can then be utilized for energy to the nanite, you know, machines within your body. So what's really interesting is, how does society change? How do these big sort of things happen. And what I wanted to do is explore some of that. So I've been writing a list, and I started the list with things like, this is, by the way, this is a good writing tip for any of you. Think about what it is that you want to write about, right? I mean, think about what's unique and interesting. And what I decided to do is everyday things. I just have a list now, brushing your teeth, going to the bathroom, just getting ready in the morning, right? Haircuts, eating, catching the bus, you know, whatever it is. And then looking at how would the world be different if nanites were the ones in charge? How centralized would the nanites be? How isolated to you? Or how connected would you be? Would the world go through a big blossoming, we're all one big nanite culture and we all share, quickly realizing privacy is gone and you're no longer a self being, and then slowly collapse back into individuals like bodies like this, and then, you know, then realizing the only way to maintain, you know, privacy, or I'm sorry, uniqueness, is to lock people's identity and looks into a genetic structure that's coded using, you know, ACTG in a DNA helix that then allows, you know, these nanitic beings to exist and not take over, or, you know, fake being someone else. Is there, what are all the implications of that? And so as I'm going through that, it's making it clearer and clearer how the magic in Mythborn is going to sort of manifest itself in books 4 and 5 as we learn more about what's going on, more about the remaking of the world, and whether or not, you know, Eric will be successful and his team will be successful in, you know, combating both Sovereign's goals and, you know, also looking at what's going on with Lilith and her goals to free her people. And you're starting to realize now that the people that are in the world, yeah, they're called demons, but at the nanitic level, they aren't, at the nanotech level, they aren't that different than flesh and blood. You know, they bleed, they have cells, they are, you know, trying to survive, they're sentient. Are they just a different life form? And if they are a different life form, what is the difference between them and true flesh and blood? And what is the galaxy today? Are true flesh and blood people extinct? Is Eden the last place that you can find some of these flesh and blood people that are left, the builders? Has everywhere else in the galaxy been, you know, essentially replaced by sentient nanitic, you know, races? So how interesting and how big does our mind start to you know, blow up when you start thinking about how this one world might be the center of a geopolitical storm that is galaxy-wide and interesting. So super excited about that. Now, we only have a little bit of time left, and I wanted to talk about two huge influences on me that I recommend highly to everyone. For those of you who have watched, you know, anything on animation on TV, please go rediscover Nickelodeon's Avatar, The Last Airbender. I'm not talking about the movie version. I have no comments about that. I am focusing on the cartoon version that was done by, I believe it's Martin, what's his name? Martin DiMartino and Konietzko, Brian Konietzko and Aaron Ahaz. You know, 61 episodes, amazing work. They're just incredible. And as a martial artist who really truly you know, grew up on the Chinese style of martial arts, a hard style, not kung fu, but I saw so many parallels in the philosophies and in the teachings of, you know, whether it was firebending, earthbending, waterbending, or airbending, all those different things. And I can't recommend their series high enough. If you have not seen it, and if you have kids, I recommend it so highly. My 5-year-old and I are watching it now, and it is one of the best things I've ever rediscovered More so because it really solicits him, or I'm sorry, really elicits him to solicit me to explain different things, like, you know, what this means. Like, what does noble mean? Now all of a sudden he understands what his name means. Or to look at the different philosophies that are being promoted there. I think the cartoon does a great way of bringing that to life. It doesn't have any blood, and you know, the violence is off screen. It, you know, clearly kids get the idea that someone got knocked out, but you know, there's I don't think there's, I haven't seen any death yet, but you know, could be, but I don't think so. And from Aaron Ejas, I hope I said, I'm saying his name right, but I really would hate to mess it up, but from him is a new series that I just started watching called The Dragon Prince. It is on Netflix. It is really good. In fact, for those of you who know the Airbender series, Sokka, the voice of Sokka, that kid is the hero in this new series. Not Sokka, but the voice of the heroes. The hero's name is Kalem. And this kid who did Sokka's voice does this kid's voice. So there's just a cool kind of like feeling that happens when I'm, you know, watching it. The animation, I would say, is better. The magic system and the world seems a little more interesting. It's not as close to the Avatar and ancient China. In fact, it's nothing like that. It's got elves and dragons and a lot more fantastic things going on. And, you know, I mean, I haven't seen enough of it to know if it's as good, because one of the things I loved about the Avatar was these long arcs, right? These long arcs of a villain becoming a hero, of a hero, you know, facing his own fears, you know, things that were just really well done over seasons rather than over one or two episodes. And I hope The Dragon Prince does the same thing. I'm going to be watching it all the time, and I will report to you guys what I think. But if Mythborn were ever to become an animated series, boy, the first people I would call would be these guys, and I would hope that they would consider, you know, translating Mythborn into an animated series. I think they are incredibly talented individuals, and I think Mythborn is made for this kind of, you know, animated treatment. So let's see what happens. I know a lot of people who know a lot of people who might know them. We'll see what happens. So, hey guys, thank you so much for tuning in to this dual episode. One on Facebook and one on YouTube. Two different perspectives, same kind of conversation. I'm super excited to be with you and talk about Mythborn as usual. Be looking for me at the Barnes & Noble November 10th. I will be there all day on Saturday. So I hope you come by. Please go check out the audiobook. Check it out, and you know, try and get it, try and download it. It's one credit. It won't cost you anything. And let me know what you think. You know, post reviews. Your reviews are the reason why people buy anything. So review. I really appreciate it. Thank you so much. Take care. Now I have to end two things at one time. First, we'll do YouTube. Take care, YouTube folks. And now we'll do Facebook. Take care, Facebook folks.